Married to one of the country's elite and political names, Margarita Tingting Cojuangco is running for a Senate seat to clean up a stained Senate. But these days, she's also challenged to clean up her own act. Here's a look.
Counted among the 100 most beautiful women in the world in 1968, she is a columnist, a celebrated socialite and philanthropist who holds a rank of colonel with the Reserve Force of the Philippine Army. Margarita Tingting Cojuangco belongs to the social and political elite with ties to the iconic Aquinos. She is married to business tycoon and former Tarlac Representative Jose Pepin Cojuangco, elder brother of the late President Corazon Aquino. But she is a public servant in her own right. From 1992 to 1998, she served as governor of Tarlac. Known for her humanitarian projects and her work among Muslim communities, she is an avowed scholar on Mindanao issues and participated in peace talks with the Moro National Liberation Front. Cojuangco also pushed for the passage of an organic act that set up the autonomous region in Muslim Mindanao. Of late, amid the Sabah standoff, she has denied links to alleged attempts to sabotage peace talks with the Moro Islamic Liberation Front. After once serving as chairman of the defunct Kabalikat ng Mamamayang Pilipino or KAMPI of former President Gloria Arroyo, this year she makes a pitch for a Senate seat under the United Nationalist Alliance. She says she will help clean up the Senate. Cojuangco is nowhere near the magic 12 in the surveys, but she is not giving up on the race to the Senate.
All right, joining us on Hot Copy, United Nationalist Alliance, or UNA senatorial candidate, Margarita Tingting Cojuangco. Good morning to you. Good day. Are you speaking terms already with President Aquino? I mean, how is your relationship like now, including your husband, Pepin, with him?
No, we never stop speaking or texting each other.
Okay.
Yes, but there's a hindrance, of course, because they don't want us there.
How do you know they don't want you there?
Well, firstly, they came out saying that I couldn't have a position. Lasherda said that. I mean, and then the second one was...
But he's anti-nepotism, that's all.
No, but that's all right. That's in the Constitution. But you don't have to announce it in the newspaper because we already had an understanding in the family, right?
Okay.
But they pick on me, you know? And then on the second occasion was that I can't be part of the peace process. You know, I didn't offer myself for the peace process. I began the peace process in 1984. You know?
Yeah, with the before
even even during Marcos' time, without even Cory being the president, I risked my life for peace. You know, and I began it in Mindanao during my scholastic studies. You know.
Okay.
Yeah. So there was a visit to a very good friend of mine in Mindanao, and Malacañang people went there and said, write a letter to the president and tell him to write and not to include her in the peace process. So Noynoy says, I never got the letter. So I told him the letter was never written because they were my friends and they refused to write the letter.
Okay.
You know what I mean? And then now they call us collaborators. No, we're not. Certainly not. They lacked in intelligence reports.
Okay. All right. Now I'm curious. I had Pepin Cojuangco here on Head Start one time. I think it was a book launch. But I asked him about his relationship with the president. And he said that as the head of the Philippine Olympic Committee, the president wouldn't even see him. Has he seen him?
I know that they saw each other once after that. Yeah, they did. But then also I think he was complaining because they took out one half of his funding and they put it in that by law, you know, you don't take out one half of the funding, you know,
because there is a law. Olympic Committee.
Yes, but the presidential management staff head about took one half of his money.
Okay. Yeah. Now, could this be, I'm just curious, I'm leading to this now, then we'll go back to Sabah. Could this be one of the reasons why you didn't support Team PNoy? I mean, it's quite interesting that you are running with UNA.
Oh, VP, well, I think, I'll tell you the story. In 1978, when PNoy wanted to run, he had no political party.
Okay.
And he was in Fort Bonifacio, incarcerated. So PNoy said to Peping, and I heard it, he says, Salonga and Ross are not supporting me because they're boycotting my elections.
Wow.
So PNoy says, I need a party. So we organized Laban. I was very young then. And so marching Mitra, but most especially VP Bina, who was the lawyer of Cory in 1978 for the elections of PNoy, was part of Laban. Mm-mm. And so was Neptali Gonzalez, all these old statesmen, you know.
Yeah.
And I was young and I looked up to them.
So this
Anding Roses. And so we formed Laban for him.
For Ninoy.
For Ninoy.
But it's quite interesting
party,
that
it's
quite interesting that Noynoy and Marongas are now with the Liberal Party, and your version of history is that Roses and
Salonga did not support.
Didn't want to support Noynoy.
It's history books, I swear.
Okay.
It's
all right.
Proof, primary source.
Okay.
And it happened again because I know that Ninoy asked, according to my husband, from a long distance call when Ninoy was in America, and says, "Look, Peping, I'm going around and I'm saying I'm a secretary general of the Liberal Party, and the Americans are saying, what's that?" He says, "Can I be the president?" And again, he was rejected.
Okay.
Yeah, again, history, that's me, I swear, it's true.
Okay.
I don't lie, I hate liars.
All right, so the reason why you chose Binay is because of your long ties with him.
Long standing. And besides, we became PDP Laban. We had a coalition with the with Pimentel. And
when you were governor of Tarlac,
I ran as PDP Laban, 92, 95, 98.
Okay.
And it's a bottoms-up decision. The PDP Laban will not decide without consultation from the lower barangay.
Okay. Now, what's very interesting, I did a bit of research, and that sometime in October, this is the year 2000, this was an excerpt from a Malaya article, a really old article. This is questioning now why you are with UNA, considering ERAP is there. In a news conference, I think Peping Cojuangco had said, this was, he joined Chavit Singson on October 9 in Club Filipino. And he, it was a news conference where the governor first claimed to have given huge payoffs to the president. Do you remember this? So this is Peping claiming that he had given wedding payoffs to ERAP in the year 2000. That's number one.
No, wait, excuse me.
Okay, are you?
Yeah. No, Peping never, but what?
Peping.
We don't know about that.
Yes, yeah. Peping bared plans to launch a nationwide movement to press Estrada's resignation then, in the year 2000.
From what Singson had told Peping, and, but you know, that's already finished, no?
Okay.
It's already finished. We never even celebrate EDSA 2 because we don't see the significance of EDSA 2 suddenly, because Corey already went to ERAP's residence and said, "I'm sorry that it happened." So we follow the leader, and Corey was the president, you know? And so Peping's the younger brother. So when Corey said, "I'm sorry" to President ERAP, it was the whole family that had to, you know, feel the same way, and
but
we do.
Do you believe it now? I mean, personally, now that you're with ERAP?
What would I believe?
I mean, do you believe now that, in other words, at that point in time, when your husband called for his resignation, wedding gate, everything, do you believe now that ERAP was innocent?
Yes, Corey said.
But even if Corey didn't say it, I'm curious what you think.
Well, we would believe her.
So in other words, you really, Corey was the, she was the dominant
factor. Her direction was what we had to follow.
Okay.
The family has really been very, very close all the time.
Okay.
Yeah, that's why even if they tried to put Noynoy and Peping and myself apart, we're never going to leave him. We're going to support him. We're going to guide as far as we can, you know, but we're never going to go on a separate way without his knowing.
Yeah. Now, but isn't this going a separate way? I mean, you being with UNA, this
Oh, I told Noynoy I was running.
All right, tell me about that.
Yeah. Okay. I told Noynoy I was running. Yeah.
And
because I told him that I couldn't have any position. You know, I've had so many, I have two doctorate degrees, criminology and history. I've been a public servant and still gone to school at the same time. I have three master's degree, national defense, public safety, Philippine history. I know Oriental history, and here I am stuck, you know, because I happen to have relatives, in-laws, Corey, and now our nephew, whom we treasure as president. So he's not going to give me a job. I can't sit home and, you know, and nobody's going to employ me and believe that Mrs. Cojuangco wants to work, you know? I want to work,
At this age.
Because you know, all the knowledge I have, and I've acquired this for 26 years. I was enrolled in Islamic studies in UP until I decided to run.
Okay. Yeah. All right. I'm happy that you mentioned that, because clearly, you're more than just a pretty face. I mean, you're accused of just being a socialite and a pretty face. I'll run it by the audience right now. You had your master's, you said it, in National Security Administration at the National Defense College. Mm-hmm. You received a doctorate degree in criminology and Philippine history. You were the president of the Philippine Public Safety College.
Yes.
All right, interesting. You were also the governor of Tarlac for, was it one term or two terms? For two terms. Why didn't you continue that at some point? I mean, you could have taken a break, had someone run, and then continue with that.
No, I didn't. Because actually the NPA was used against me.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Did you lose?
It was a very sad election. Yes, yeah. In 98, yes.
Okay, after
yes.
98.
Someone whom Peping had taken care of for 50 years longer than he took care of me.
Yeah.
Yeah, challenged me. But he had ties with the NPA, yeah, being part of the peace process. And he bought votes at about 1,500 per vote. And I said, I'm not going to buy votes, no. I don't want to buy votes for the people I'm going to serve. Yeah, and then the sample ballots and then the real ballots were in his residence. But then, you know, I couldn't do anything about it.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Yeah. Now, you were presidential assistant in 2001. This was GMA's time. But I think what many people don't know, maybe we can discuss this a bit, is you were already in the MILF peace talks when it wasn't even in fashion.
Yeah.
That's like 1984 yes, to 1985.
Yes. Yes, yeah. No, longer. To about 87,
okay.
88, yes.
Now that was
yeah.
unsuccessful then. Comment on.
Yes.
Of course, the MILF then was very different.
I think it was successful, actually.
Okay.
Actually, the MILF broke.
But they must have been very rabid then.
No.
They were the rabid version then.
No, no.
No?
The MNLF and the MILF were together.
Okay.
But in 1977 or 78, I think they had a misunderstanding with Normie Suari.
Yeah.
Who, by the way, is my compadre also, okay?
Okay.
Yeah,
okay.
From a Palawan wedding. And they broke off because they wanted to make their cause Islamic, not
okay,
national.
Go on. Yeah.
Yes. So I was studying then in Mindanao, that was 1983. I dared go there because I was asked by Peping to organize yeah. in the Muslim areas because of my studies.
Now, how old were you then?
Oh, my gosh. I'm not going to say because you know how to read, how to track. You're sneaky, huh? Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So in order to make Corey Wayne, because eventually Peping said, okay, from your school work, we're now going to go into political work. So I had a lawyer friend who eventually became the governor of the first armed governor, Zacaria Candao.
Okay.
And Congressman Balindong. Said, okay, Ting, I'm going to introduce you to Zacaria Candao, said Congressman Balindong of Lano Sur, Malabang. And so we had a secret meeting, yeah. And so he was Zacaria Candao, who was an MILF supporter.
Okay.
Yeah. And he said, okay, I'm going to fix you a meeting with Gagi Murad.
Okay.
So we went to Kapo Bubakar, and there were no roads, you know?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It was terrible.
All right. Okay,
you know?
Now very quickly, what did you achieve as part of that peace process?
Well, we had the final meeting. Finally, we had the meeting. In Simbuay Crossing in Maguindanao.
Okay.
And that was in 1987, as soon as Corey had assumed. Because all the commanders asked me, and Kagi Murad was, we don't want secession. We want to join the government, but we want to do it peacefully according to ancestral domain. Then, so they haven't changed their stance, you know.
Okay.
And
now,
compadre ko na yan.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, move fast forward from 1984, when you were involved in the MILF peace talks, to the Bangsamoro Framework Agreement. Comments on it?
Well, I translated through Dato Pak's Maganda Datos printing of the book that said the Organic Act for Muslim Mindanao.
Okay.
And I translated it with Judge Kadir Indar. It's a beautiful piece of work, you know.
When you say you translated, I mean,
yes,
forgive
it was
me.
Basically in Tagalog, and we put it in proper English.
Oh, right? That's it.
Yeah,
okay,
so,
all right.
To make it more clear,
okay.
No? So, and many of those provisions there have not been exercised.
Okay.
Yes, like they can on their own get foreign countries to come to the arm. You know, they were like a little republic.
Okay.
Pero hindi nila sinunod sayang. Mm-hmm. And now, that Organic Act is going to be thrown into the basura, which is so hard to do.
Yeah,
and
but
now
that
a new framework will come up. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah,
but
so
new
why
framework,
don't they use that Organic Act included
yes,
in the framework?
Yes, they should, because it's done by their own people.
Really?
Yes, and approved by the Constitutional Convention during Corey's time.
But did you tell this? Did you tell, like, Secretary Gingdeles this? I think she'll appreciate it.
I think she won't appreciate it.
Why? You're hilarious.
They want to do their own. They don't want to use something that's been done by a previous administration, even
but
if it belongs.
That's still Cory's.
I know.
That's Cory's time.
Well, that's for them to decide, you know. But,
yeah, but have they actually seen it? Did you?
They should. They should have read it back to back. If you see my book, it's torn.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Now, do you think, in connection with the Bangsamoro Framework Agreement, that the Royal Army did this because they weren't excluded from that agreement?
Well, they wanted to be part of the agreement, but they were not. But you know what
was
happens?
Was that the motive? Was that the motive in invading?
Time out, huh? Me first, huh?
Yeah, go. Okay.
Oh, we're good friends.
Go on.
We're funny friends.
Okay,
But what is happening in North Borneo should not affect the peace talks because North Borneo is not part of ARM. So, walang problema, di ba?
No, but it's the role of Malaysia, apparently.
But you know, aren't we big enough or small enough with big brains in order to understand that if Malaysia facilitates their is a facilitator, but that's one problem put on one side. The North Borneo is a proprietary problem between Malaysia and Kiram.
Yeah, that's true.
Ours is a sovereignty problem between the president of the republic and Malaysia.
Okay.
So now they're saying that as a conspirator, that we are hindering the peace talks. That's another pronouncement of Malacanang. Come on, you know, hello, wake up. You know, this can be done, you know, on a separate basis.
So what?
You know, like if Malaysia is an intermediary, why do we have to meet in Malaysia? Why can't we meet in ARM? You know, why do we need a foreign country to come when this is our policy? If Sri Lakagi Murad already decided, you know, and they were like referees, you know, Malaysia is a referee, that 1899 Kiram-based treaty allowed the Americans to come in, right, in the letter of Salamat. So therefore, yung letter na nga, invited the Americans to come in the foreign country, you know, to be all part of the peace process.
Oh my God, you're a freaking expert in this. Okay, wait, I'm gonna ask you, what should PNoy do now? Is there still hope?
I think this little pretty mini for auntie,
know, what do you think?
Who studied all of this culture.
So what should he do now?
And history, there should be a ceasefire.
PNoy should call for that. But the Malaysian Prime Minister said no more negotiations. Remember
But PNoy is the president of the Philippines and the president of the Muslims and the Moros. You know, he should.
So is the right
now
word...
Now this keeps me mum.
Is the right word ceasefire instead of using the word surrender?
Unilateral ceasefire and exchange of prisoners.
Really?
Yes.
Unilateral ceasefire. This is your... Okay, can you expand on that? That's interesting.
Okay.
Let's see.
On a ceasefire, the Philippines will have... will lay down their ammunition.
The Royal Sultanate Army.
Yes.
You mean?
Yes. And also the Malaysians.
Okay.
Because if... I was on my way to Tarlac and I could hear bang, 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 and it was the cell phone of the Rajamuda who was in Malaysia, and they said, sniper, sniper. And I said, who fired first?
You know? Yeah, you wouldn't know
right.
anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So they claim that the Malaysians fired first. I would say, oh my God, my Muslims, you know, my Filipino blood, you know,
yeah.
they're being fired upon. You know, so I would, you know, ask, you know, send immediately somebody within an hour to Malaysia, you know, and clarify the matter.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
But now you also have prisoners, so you have to have the release of prisoners. Filipinos release our prisoners back to the Malaysians. Malaysians give us back their prisoners.
Oh, very interesting.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
Okay, because I think Fatima had said that they had allegedly 10 prisoners?
Yes.
10 Malaysian prisoners?
Yeah, 10. So why not exchange? That's the beginning of goodwill, to sit down in a square, triangle, round, octagonal table, whatever it is, you know, but it's a start.
Okay.
Yes.
All right, very interesting. We're going to...